Thank you. Where's the new This is my beloved son. Hear him. And once the voice was uttered, whilst the voice was uttered, Jesus was following Rome. And they held their peace and told no man in those days any of these things which they had seen. Today calls us in a very needful time to ponder what it means to celebrate a prophet. For that is what we are doing today. Through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we are honoring this man we know as Saint Elias, one of the key figures in the Old Testament, someone that we Carmelites identify as a father. What is very dangerous, my brothers and sisters, for us to merely ponder on a prophet, for a prophet is meant to challenge us. And what do the prophets, the Old Testament, remind us? They remind us of the simple, fallen human reality that we are idolaters. We are God makers. We worship idols. We allow ourselves to succumb to things lesser than God Almighty. And the prophets came to wake us up to this reality, to challenge us to return to the true relationship to the one true God. Therefore, we must be willing to acknowledge on this day as the gift of honor to the prophet Elias, celebrating our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that we are idolaters, that we have fallen short of the great gift and of the great relationship that comes about through our lives in Jesus Christ, the life brought about in Him via our sacrament of baptism that we are all brought into and given. Now, this is a reality that we must confront, we must deal with. Our idols are a means for us to gain some level of control in a world that seems chaotic. Our idols tend to desire to make things that are transcendent down to earth so we can manipulate, we can control, we can set things on our terms. But the danger of our idols are this: they may give us the mirage of control, they may give us the mirage of stability. But idols are thieves. Idols steal life. They can never give life. They steal it from us. Only the one true God can give us life. And not only does He give us life, He pours it upon us overabundantly. And the idols that we manufacture in our lives, that we create in our lives, steal this life from us. They are like those robbers in the night that we hear about. Now, what are we to do? The medicine had been taught to us. It was foreshadowed in the prophets of the Old and testified to at the very beginning of the ministry of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And the medicine is this: repent and believe in the gospel. Something that is not just meant to be a one-time thing in our lives, but is necessary medicine that we have to take over and over and over again. Why? Because our hearts are easily seduced. They easily succumb to these idols that we make in our lives. Those lies that we tell ourselves about dropping a knee at these things that we wish for our gods, that we think can satisfy our appetites. The prophets remind us of the necessity of becoming awake. We hear about wokeness all the time in the world. But the one area in which we need to become awake in is our relationship to the one true God. And how those things in our life, our idols, make us dull, they make us tired, they make us lazy. Why? Because they're like vampires, they steal life from us. And we return and become open to and reinvigorated in this gift of divine life by repenting from the old ways and believing in Jesus Christ. Now, of course, the prophets remind us in dramatic ways in the Old Testament, constantly going not necessarily to the foreign nations, but to their own people. Reminding them how they are getting off the mark, how they are drifting away in the ramifications that we experience, not just as individuals, but as the people when we drift away from the one true God. Prophets again challenge us to see the ramifications of our idolatry, of serving lesser gods instead of the one true God. We begin to see when we are open to the spirit of repentance. Not because we're wicked, evil beings. No, no. From our very moments of existence, God says that we are good. So when we repent, we are moving from ways of death to a way of life. And when we begin to believe in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which is already an act of the Holy Spirit within our lives, we begin to journey ever anew down that way of faith. Now, what are we to do? We have been told for at least a generation or two now the need of a new evangelization. And in order to evangelize those that have, quote unquote, already heard the gospel, we must be willing to first stop, break the chains that keep us from internalizing the gospel, from allowing the gospel to penetrate our hearts. We cannot spread the word of God unless the word of God is first taken root in our hearts. I was made the heart a place of stone, no seed can grow there. Repentance is a means of tilling the soil. Belief is a way of bringing about that rich means of fertilization, which the Holy Spirit does. Not just a little again, but overabundantly. Something that we hear about in the life of Elias. When Elisha asked for a double portion, God never holds back. We put limits on God. Why? Because we are afraid. Because our hearts are easily succumbing to fear. Now, we overcome that fear by repenting and knowing that our Lord is with us. That's what I believe teaches us. It's not a high in the sky reality. No. The incarnation reminds us of the closeness of our God through the man we know as the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And in order to give this medicine to others, to help others realize that they need this medicine, to wake themselves up to the idolatry in their life, we must first take it. We must first acknowledge our idols. We must have them destroyed in our lives by the flames of the Holy Spirit. We cannot share what we do not have. We cannot give what we have not first received. So, when we celebrate the Mass, it is a moment for us to become awake to the necessity of celebrating, honoring, worshiping, and giving glory over to the one true God who speaks to us, who whispers to us in love to bring us back to himself. He doesn't yell at us. He whispers to us. Again, something we see in the life of Elijah. All the different calamities that was on Mount Moriah. It was in a still small breeze, a still small voice that Elijah hears the Lord speaking to him. He does the same for us. But our idols make us deaf. They block our ears. Our idols want us to remain in the muck instead of rising up and rejoicing in the gift of our daughterhood and our sonship, which have been freely bestowed upon us by the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And this medicine is not just for the select few, but it's meant for everybody. We don't hold back the gospel. We give the gospel. Just as the prophets went to the people, they didn't say, well, these people in the Jewish circles, these people in the Jewish, no. To the people of God, we must be willing to go out and to do likewise. Elijah didn't pick who he was meant to go to. He went where he was told to go. We need to do likewise. And we are able to act with that courage and boldness of the Spirit when we first become awake to the reality of what binds us, what keeps us from responding to the presence of the Lord in our life, which of course, as I've already said several times before, is our idols. Those things that we create that we worship. Maybe not necessarily physical structures. It could be something as insidious as ideologies. We all have different ideas that we can easily raise up and put over others, oppressing them, pushing them down. Saying that if you do not conform to these idols that I have created, I cast you out, or worse, I get rid of you. Now, this is drastic, yes, but idols steal life. And we are not meant for death, but we are meant for life, my brothers and sisters. That is what we celebrate when we are in the Mass, the gift of new life. And we are commissioned at the end of Mass to go forward and to make that right now. So we're not meant to do it selectively, but literally, to all people that our Father sent to us, that we lead out into the world. So by acknowledging our idolatry, and through the grace of the work of the Holy Spirit in our life, smashing those things, casting them aside, we are able to share the overabundance of God's grace and life to all those people that the Father wishes for us to encounter in our daily lives. Now, what can we begin with? What can we start with? How do we take that first step? Of course, we repent, we believe, but then after that, that third step, we have hope. We have hope. That even if we fall short, that even if we mess up, God's will be done in the world. Yes, we aren't perfect. Yes, we fall short. That's one side of the point of our fallen nature. The other side is that reality, I've already said, we are good. It is good that each and every one of you exists. And even those people in the world that may drive you nuts, it's good that they exist. And we share with them, whether we like to or not, whether they give joy to our heart or not, we share with them the grace and the joy and the splendor that comes from life rooted in Jesus Christ. So may we not allow our hearts to grow barren because the idols we have manufactured, those idols that we desire to give us those menial little comforts of a day-to-day life. But may we be bold, and may we act with faith and hope in the great work of the Spirit that has been sent unto us, the Spirit that makes us all working in the life of lives, a Spirit that has brought us to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, a Spirit that has set our hearts ablaze on fire, a Spirit that makes our hearts fertile soil, so the seeds that are given to us by Jesus Christ may grow abundantly and nourish all the people in the world. May we be open to the work of the Holy Spirit. So when we give honor, glory, and praise to our Lord, whether in this form of worship or out in the world, we can do it with such force that we can set the world ablaze as Christ has called forward through his ministry on earth. We are not meant for fear, but we are meant for love. A love that makes known the eternal life. Let us not be easily seduced by the idols of our life, but let us seek freedom in Christ made known through the Spirit, so we can share that gift of Jesus in the world with the fortitude of the Spirit, freeing our brothers and sisters from the idolatries in their life, so they may know the freedom of the Lord as we know the freedom of the Lord, that they may know the love of the Lord as we know the love of the Lord. Not just in little ways, but in grand ways, overflowing and abundant. Remember, you are made for love, not for fear. You are not made for idols, but for the one true God. May this celebration today aid you in that gift of freedom that our Lord desires for each one of you.
Et ex pro
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, Thank you.
young